Well, good morning, kids. You guys all right? God been blessing you this week? Going through trials?
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Good for you. I've been really getting blessed by going through the parables that Jesus taught and chewing on them. I've never really just sat down and analyzed and studied and checked out what Jesus was saying in all these parables, and he taught a lot of parables. But you know, when you break them all down, you guys, he's basically saying the same thing over and over to us. He's saying, get your eyes off of this world and get your focus on God. You know why he says that to us? Because he loves us. Do you guys know how much God loves you? He loves you this much, amen? Amen? He loves you this much. You know, in the bathroom by my office, I go in there quite frequently. Praise the Lord. Because there's a little, my wife put a little thing above the toilet, right at eye level. I know she did that for me. And know what it says? Three little words. Jesus loves you. And I read that probably 15 times a day. To giving up how much I go to the bathroom. I think I drink too much water. But you know, I'm over there. It's so cool because I keep reading. And this morning I was reading that. I go, God, you are so good. I'm thankful for my wife. I'm thankful for my life. You know? And I'm so thankful that God loves me. That, you know, I don't know about you, but I have bad days. Anybody here have bad days? Where you don't feel all that saved? Anybody feel like you're not saved sometimes? Everybody raises their hand. Yeah, this morning. Guess what? We're not saved by how good we are, amen? We're saved by how good he is. And he is so good. And he's so good to us. We're going to be in Luke chapter 12. And I'm going to kind of go over the whole chapter a little bit, taking pieces, bits and pieces out of it. But this message is the faithful and wise servant. And when I wrote down faithful, I put faith, and then I put skipped a space and put full. And I didn't do it on purpose, but afterwards I looked at it and I go, thank you, Lord. My faith needs to be full. Amen? For me to be faithful, I got to be full of faith. If I'm not full of faith in God, guess what? I'll serve God when I feel like it. But if I'm full of faith, I'm going to go, you know what? I need to get my eyes off myself, off this world. And I need to get my eyes where it belongs, upon my Creator, the Creator of heaven and earth, the one that the Bible says in Psalms 139 that He formed me in my mother's womb, that He was there at the very beginning, that as I was being formed, He was there. He was the one that was putting together my DNA, causing my eyes to be brown, causing my hair to be brown, causing me to be so good. That's enough. But God was there from the beginning. He loves us. Isn't it good to be loved? Let's pray. We're going to get into this awesome passage of Scripture. Your Father, we thank you for this Bible. Thank you for sending your Son Jesus. And He just laid out all these stories with great morality and to show us the love that you have for us. You're concerned about our life. You know every hair on our head. That's how much you're concerned about us. So Lord, help us as we begin to read, to just take hold of these words, every one of them, that you say to us that you love us and you're concerned about us and what we're thinking, what we're doing, if we're worrying, all those things, if we're anxious for things. Lord, you want us to not be tripping on anything. Because you got it all under control. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I'm going to start with verse 41. I'm going to read through to verse 48. Okay? Everybody there? Okay. In verse 41, then Peter said to him, Lord, do you speak this parable only to us or to all people? And the Lord said, who then is that faithful and wise steward or servant, whom his master will make ruler over his household, to give them their portion of food in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his master will find so doing when he comes. Truly I say to you that he will make him ruler over all that he has.
Wow, that's a lot, huh?
But, verse 45, the big but right there. But if that servant says in his heart, my master is delaying his coming, and begins to beat the male and female servants, and to eat and drink and be drunk. In other words, do things that are ungodly, just ignoring the things God has said. He says, the master of that servant will come on a day when he is not looking for him, at an hour when he is not aware. Were you thinking that Jesus was coming this morning? Don't say yes. Probably everybody here was going, I didn't even think about that. But what does he say? At an hour when he is not aware. And will cut him into and appoint his portion with the unbelievers, or the unfaithful would be a better word. And so he's saying, I'm going to take it and distribute it amongst the unfaithful. And that, we're talking about eternal things here, is what he's talking about. And that servant who knew his master's will, and did not prepare himself or do according to his will, shall be beaten with many stripes. I don't believe that he's saying that he's going to beat us, but I believe he is saying that you're going to lose out if you're not subtle down. Amen? You're going to lose out on some eternal rewards that God has for you, that he has for me. And then verse 40, he said, but he who did not know, yet committed things deserving stripes, shall be beaten with few. For everyone to whom much is given, from him much will be required, and to whom much has been committed, of him they will ask more. Jesus is saying, if you didn't know that much, you're not going to be as responsible as the person that knows a lot in the Lord and still didn't do it. Remember when we're looking at the two sons, and the one said, hey, I'll go ahead and do it. And he didn't do it. And then the other son said, no, I don't want to do it, but then went ahead and did it. And remember the Pharisees said, he asked them, which one did the right thing? Jesus asked the Pharisees. And he said, the first one was the one that said, no, I'm not going to do it, and then did it. And do you remember what Jesus said to the Pharisees? He said, the prostitutes and tax collectors go to heaven before you. Why did he say that? Because the Pharisees knew the right answer, but they wouldn't do it. And that's what Jesus is saying again right here, is that when we know to do the right things and we refuse to do it, you're robbing yourself from eternal rewards. Now think about this. Jesus is talking to his disciples. But look at verse 1 of chapter 12. It says, in the meantime, when an innumerable multitude of people had gathered together. So he's talking to his disciples, but who's there? A number of people, you can't even number all of them. There's so many people, there's thousands of people here, and they're gathered together, and he begins to speak. Now he's speaking towards his disciples, but he's got all these people all around him. It's like, if we're right here, right now, there's people just in the streets, everywhere around, behind me, everywhere. And I'm talking to 12 guys right here. Just 12 guys. That's what's going on. What's the first thing that he says to these guys? Look at what he says in verse 1 over here. Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. Now, I want to just focus on these for a second, and then we'll get back into faithful and unfaithful servants. But the first thing he mentions to them in the midst of all these people is beware. Then look over verse 15. He says again, beware of covetousness. So there's two things he says beware of. One was the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. The second is beware of covetousness, which is greediness, building bigger barns, heaping to myself treasures, right? So the first one, he says, is the leaven, which is really the teaching of the Pharisees. Leaven is rotten bread that's inside, and it causes the bread to rise. Okay? And so what he's saying is 11, the bad teaching of the Pharisees, which puffs them up and makes them think there's something. Be careful. Now we need to be careful today, don't we? Because we have bad teaching all around us, don't we? Everywhere you go, in the church, outside the church, on TV, they're teaching you stuff that's so ungodly, right? And when Jesus says beware, should we beware?
Amen.
You ever went to a house and said beware of a dog? You think twice about going to the backyard. Huh? Everyone will tell me my brother did a roofing dove a long time ago. And there's a big old white pit bull like the one I got in the backyard. So my brother goes like this. He goes, I'll tell you what. He goes, go over there and get his attention. So I got up on top of the garage and I start banging up, yelling at the dog, you know, and the dog goes right over behind the garage, crazy. Oh man, I don't want to fall off this roof. So my brother opens the gate, goes up, oh man, he's got more guts than I did. Goes inside and plugs in the compressor, it goes on, right? And here comes the dog. And I go, get out of the yard! You know, but that's how we should be with, when Jesus says be aware of something, we should be like that pit bull in the backyard, right? I'm not going there. I am not going. So I said that because we need to be aware of bad teaching. You need to check me, right? The Bible says, be as the Bereans and search the scriptures. You need to check my teaching. Make sure I'm telling you the truth, okay? Is that okay with you guys? How do you do that? You go to the Word of God and investigate. So the next one is, he says, beware of covetousness, which is greediness. Remember right after this, when he says, beware of covetousness, he goes into the guy that built bigger barns. He said, I have so much, my soul is merry. I'm so glad I'm going to build bigger barns. Do you remember what Jesus called the guy? You guys know. You read this passage of Scripture. He called him a fool. When Jesus calls somebody a fool, you better pay attention. That's not very nice. He called him a fool. Why? Because his whole thought pattern was on this side. Is there anything wrong with having riches? No. There's nothing wrong with having money. But when your whole life is money, your whole life is your job, your whole life is the things you have, guess what? You're in a bad place. That's why God said, fool, cut it out. Hey, fool. Hey, fool. That's when you stop right there. Don't do that, man. Don't get your focus on the here and now. There's nothing wrong. I enjoy having a motorcycle to ride. Amen? I like it. I like jumping on the thing and riding. But I enjoy more sitting in the morning, opening up the Bible, talking to the Lord, and seeking Him for my day. That's where I get my strength. See, that motorcycle, if I go really hard through hard times, I can't go over and talk to that motorcycle. Harley. I'm going through a really rough time right now. That money ain't going to do nothing for me. But I'll tell you what Jesus does. And he's laying out this picture in front of all these people. And then he goes on. And the third thing he begins to tell the crowd, he's basically focusing in on the disciples, is something that I think everybody in this room has done this week. Worry. And be anxious. And that's what he says. Look at in verses 21 through 30. Look at verse 22. Therefore I say to you, Jesus says, do not worry. Then look at verse 25. And which of you by worrying can add one cubit to its stature? Look at verse 26. If then you are not able to do the least, why are you anxious for the rest? Then look at verse 29. And do not seek what you should eat or what you should drink, nor have an anxious mind. Remember Philippians 4:6, it says, be anxious for nothing. You know, when we get too anxious, I really think it brings on anxiety. Have you ever been so anxious for something that it turned out not half of what you thought it was going to be? Huh? And you're all excited, you know, just, oh man, your mind is just thinking about that. And the day comes, you go, that's what Jesus said, don't worry. Be happy. God wrote a song about it. But Jesus said, don't worry about things. What can we do about that we're in, we're not going to add anything. We're not going to help it any. Are we? No. By worrying, in fact, you know, statistics show that 95% of the things we worry about never happen. You know that? How many people felt really sick and felt they were going to die? Anybody thought that? I think I got cancer. You know, as soon as we get sick or we're feeling bad, what was the first thing? Cancer. I got cancer. I remember my stomach, I guess I ate some bad food, it was just jacking me up, and I thought for sure I had stomach cancer. That's what this is going to be. It's over. And I'm right that deep the way I used to. Do you remember Jacob? I shared this story the other day. Jacob, remember when Joseph got put into prison? His brothers sold him into slavery, they brought the coat back, and it was all bloody, and he said, you got hit, you know, eaten by an animal. And Joseph, or Jacob, was just wiped out. That was, him and Benjamin were the favorites. Those were Rachel's boys. And he was just bummed out. So what happens? A famine comes upon the land, and the brothers that sold him into slavery had to go to Egypt. When they went to Egypt, who's there? Second in command, their brother Joseph. They didn't recognize him. It had been so long. And the dream that he had was that you guys are going to bow down to me. And remember, that's what caused them to throw him in that dish and sell him into slavery. And remember when Jacob was brought to Egypt and he got to see his son. There's Joseph. He's alive. Could you imagine? You thought all these years that your son's dead, and there he is in front of you alive. You remember what Jacob said? He goes, now I can die. He lived another 37 years. But that's how we are. We worry about everything, don't we? We worry about everything. Don't worry about stuff. Then Jesus goes on in verse 31 through 40, and he begins to tell us the way we should live. This is the way we should live. You guys listening? Is everybody listening?
Yes.
Is everybody awake?
Yes.
You guys okay? You know, they say attention span only lasts about 20 minutes. So at about 20 minutes, I'm going to all stand up and do jumping jacks. Right? And then we're sitting back down like we're just starting. No, I'm just kidding. And then looking at verse 31 through 40, he gives us the way we're supposed to live. And look at verse 31, it says, but seek the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added to you. All, everything. The things that you're worrying about. Oh, I don't have enough money to pay my rent. Is God able? Of course he's able. You know, if you're in a place and you can't pay your rent right now, God probably wants you to move. You ever think about that? Because he's able. He is able. But right here it says, and then he says in verse 32, it says, do not fear, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you what? The kingdom. The kingdom. He said, God's going to give us the kingdom. So what are we tripping on rent for? What are we tripping on the little things? My daughter in Texas, my youngest daughter, Melanie, they were driving around her car. They kept overheating. And finally, they're going down the freeway. She's telling her husband, which when he gets out there, they're coming here next month, and I'm going to beat you down. I'll just get you. He drives it until it stops and then pulls over. Then he pours water in. He shuts it off and pours water in. So are they going through it? Yeah. Who's going to pay for it?
You.
That's right. That's right. But not always. For them to seek the Lord first. And when you seek the Lord first, you get wisdom to put water in your car while it's running, not while it's off. Amen? So pray for me when I see my son-in-law in about a month and a half, that I don't kill him. Okay? But you know, right here, Jesus gives, he says right in verse 35, look, I'm not going to go through all of it. But verse 34 says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. What did he just talk about? teaching, and what does he talk about? About building bigger barns and all that stuff. And he says, where your treasure is, there your heart's going to be. So if my treasure is in my motorcycles, in my cars, in my house, if that's all my treasure, then guess what's going to happen? I'm not going to be building up treasures up there. Right? I want to store up treasures in heaven. You know, I want to have. Did you ever hear the thing I want my cake and eat it too? I like that saying. I had some cake yesterday. It was really good at the wedding. That's really good cake. But having your cake and eat it too, having it here and having it there, that's what I want. And guess what? I do have it here and I do have it there. Can you have it that way? Yes, you can. You know what the key is? That you focus on heaven as much as you do. That you give God his time. Right here, seek first the kingdom of God. Matthew 6:33 says the same thing, right? And then what's he saying? In verse 37, now this is part of it. Looking to God, reading your Bible, praying. But then he says this. Verse 36, blessed are those servants whom the master, when he comes, will find watching. So what's another thing we should be doing? We should be looking for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, our church believes in the pre-trib rapture. Does anybody know what pre-trib rapture is? Raise your hand if you know what pre-trib rapture is. So most of you don't know what pre-trib rapture is? Let me explain it to you, because that's fine if you don't know, but listen so you can learn. Okay? Pre-trib rapture is the rapture of the church. It is spoken of in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and 1 Corinthians 15. It talks about God taking his people out of this world. Remember how God delivered his people in the flood? He delivered his people from Sodom and Gomorrah. Well, it says there's coming a time when God is going to deliver his people out of this world before what? Before he sends his wrath down upon it. It's the last 7-year period spoken of in Daniel. And we're not going to get into all that, but it's a 7-year tribulation period. Now, some people, now you got different views. You got pre-trib, you got mid-trib, and you got post-trib. Pre-trib says we will be out of here before the Antichrist is revealed. Before anything happens, before God sends his anger down. Mid-trib says we're going to go halfway through it. There's people that believe that. The first half of the tribulation is going to be prosperity. The Antichrist is going to have all the solutions for the world problems as we see it today. Does the world have problems? All kinds of problems. He's going to have the solutions. Post-trib says that at the very end of the tribulation, we are going to be taken up and then come right back down. So, I like what David Hawking, anybody know who David Hawking is? He said he is so pre-trib rapture that he won't even eat post-trib. I know I post-trib, but I am pre-trib rapture. I believe that God's word clearly says that he's going to take us out of here. In Revelation chapter 3, when he's talking to the church in Philadelphia, he said, you know, to be right that you may be delivered from the wrath to come. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, it says that he has not appointed us to his wrath. So I believe in pre-trib. You know what pre-trib, believing in the pre-trib rapture does for you? Listen, you guys know what it does? It causes us to live a holy life. If I truly believe God can come anytime, Jesus can come any minute, I'm going to be less likely to be going out into the street and being stupid and doing things that I know are opposed to God. And I truly believe that Christ is coming at any minute. I was watching years ago, there's a pastor on there, he's 85 years old. There's no doubt this guy's with Jesus now. But he's studying prophecy his whole life. He said, there's nothing left to be fulfilled. He said, Christ come at any minute. So we need to live that way. That's the way Jesus is talking right here. He's telling us to be ready, to live rightly, to do the right thing, to be seeking God, not to be tripping on how much money you're getting, not to be tripping on all this other stuff. but to be ready. And then, look at Peter. We're finding to the text here. I won't go a long time on this. But Peter says to him, Lord, do you speak this parable only to us? Are to all people? Isn't that a great question? Here's Peter listening to him. Peter is the guy that always speaks his mind. There's people like that in this church. You don't have to wonder what they're thinking because it comes right out of their mouth. That was Peter. The Lord gets up here. What does Peter do? He goes, is that for just us? Or are you talking to everybody? Let me tell you something. The Word of God is never just for us. It is for us. But it's never just for us. It's for everybody. God wrote this Bible and he spoke these words for everybody. It's so important that we know these words and share them with other people because these words are a matter of life and death. You believe that? You believe it? So he says the Lord answers him and he talks about being faithful. Watch this. Then Peter said to him, said to the Lord, do you speak this parable only to us or to all people? And the Lord said, who then is that faithful and wise steward whom his master will make ruler over his household to give them their portion of food in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his master will find doing so when he comes. Truly I say to you that he will make him ruler over all that he has. Look at what Jesus is saying. He's talking about somebody that is faithful. Faithful in what? The things we just talked about. Seeking God. Not tripping on money. Seeking the Lord first. Right? Watching for the coming of the Lord. He said, when you're faithful in these things and you're sold out for me. I know you guys, there's so many of you sold out. Some of you are kind of like on the fence right now. Some of you aren't all that sold out. But he talks about faithfulness. He talks a lot about faithfulness in the Bible. You know, he says in Luke chapter 16 that we are to be faithful in what we have. Look at Luke chapter 16 and verses 10 through 12. Look at what the Lord says. And we need to take this to heart. Jesus says, he who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much. And he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in much. Therefore, if you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon or money, things that you got in here, who will commit to you, to your trust, the true riches? In other words, the spiritual things of God. God's not going to entrust that to you if you can't be faithful for what you have here. And he said, and if you have not been faithful in what is another man's, who will give you what is your own? Now, the Lord is talking about us being faithful in the little bit of stuff we have. Now, I'm looking at my life. I want to be faithful. First place I want to be faithful is to God. Amen? I want to be faithful to God. I don't want to play games with God. I know that he knows everything about me. I know he knows where I go. He knows what I think. He knows what I do. And that scares me. Because I know God is a holy God and he's a just God. So I want to be faithful to him. When I find my eyes wandering and a good-looking girl walks by, and I know God's watching. Right? Train the eyeballs, boys. God's watching. How about with my family? I want to be faithful with my family. I've got a wife, a beautiful wife. I don't know why God gave me a beautiful wife. And such an awesome, caring, diligent woman. She is so good to me. I honestly don't deserve her. But I'm taking her. She's mine. But I want to be faithful to her. And I'm not going to get into my old life. My old life was unfaithful as unfaithful to God. But in my new life with Christ, I've been saved now over 32 years. I've been walking with the Lord. Man, what a blessing. If it wasn't for giving my heart to Jesus, I know I would either be in prison or in the grave, one or the other. But instead, I'm standing on a stage in front of behind a pulpit and speaking the gospel to you guys. And I asked when I first got saved, and I know my heart says, just like the Bible, the heart is deceitful and desperately wicked. That's me. But with Christ in me, I can do all things. I can get rid of that. When I came to the Lord, I said this. I said, God, help me to be faithful to Tina, to not have a desire for any other woman, but to be faithful to her. And we've been married now for 31 years, and never, you know, divorce has never come up in our marriage, not one time. Not one time. Why? Because of God's faithfulness. I've been faithful to him, she's been faithful to him, and he's been faithful to us. We're faithful. I want to be faithful. I want to be faithful in supplying for my family. That I would go to work. My dad was as faithful as you could be when it comes to some of these things, especially with supplying the needs of his family. He wasn't that close of a father, but he was a very faithful man when it came to going to work and supplying for his family. He never told me he loved me through my whole life. And on his deathbed, me and my twin brother, who's with Jesus now, we said, we had heard a message by Charles Stanley, and he said, baby, the reason your dad never told you he loved you is because his dad never told him. He said, if you're born again and you know, it's up to you to tell him. I'll never forget going to that hospital and telling my dad I loved him. You know what he did? He said, I love you too. Isn't that awesome? All it took was for me to say it, for my brother to say it. And my dad, before he died, got to tell his kids he loved him. Man, God is so awesome. He's so awesome. He made sure that my dad didn't deserve heaven just like I don't. But my dad, at the last minute of his life, you know, my dad used to tell me, what do I want to go to heaven for? I'm not going to know anyone. I said, I'm going to be there. Come on. But I don't even say I wasn't. But that's what I told him. I'm going to be there, Dad. You know, at the end of his life, he gave his life to the Lord. But I want to be faithful with my family. I want to be faithful in the small things that God has given me. In any ministry that God gives me, I want to be faithful in that ministry to the Lord. I want to be accountable for what he's given me. And if God said open the books, I would say, here, it's all right there. I don't want to be unfaithful. I want to be faithful in my words, the things that I say. I don't want to be an outsider. If I have something to say about you, I'll say it to your face. Okay? And if you have something to say to me, say it to my face. It's so much better to talk to each other than behind each other's back. Listen, you can talk behind my back all you want as long as you're saying good things. Amen?
Amen.
And I'll talk behind your back all the time as long as I'm talking good about you, right? That's faithful in my words. And I'm going to be faithful in my words. But then, faithful in my walk. God wants me to have a walk that will glorify him. And in 2 Corinthians 5 says, for we walk by faith, not by sight. I want to walk by faith. And I want to have a walk that's pleasing to God. One that God looks down and says, that's my boy. That's my boy. I don't want him to look down and go, God, there he is again. And I know some Christians like that, that they just continually bump their head. And you know what keeps me from doing that is the fact that I really believe Jesus could come at any minute. But, you know, the main thing is, you know, God is faithful to us, isn't he? My wife, beautiful wife Tina, when we were raising our kids and they were real little, she used to put on these cassette tapes we had back then. You know, they didn't have CDs and iPods. And there was this one song that she used to sing in the statement that said, the Lord is faithful. And then it was, give the scripture, 2 Thessalonians 3:3. And I memorized it by that little cassette tape. But the Lord is faithful to us. It says, even when we're faithless, he remains faithful to us. And one thing we don't want to be is unfaithful to Him. You know, in the book of Hosea, speaking of unfaithfulness, I want to talk about the unfaithful servant. We're going to close here real quick. But in the book of Hosea, God told him to marry a prostitute. And when he did, this prostitute had three children by three different guys. The first child he named Jezreel, that means I will avenge. The second child they named Lo-Ruhma, which means no mercy. And the third child is Lo-Ami, which means not my people. God was speaking to Israel because Israel continually went against God's word. And God says, you are not my people. You got to check yourself, you guys. If you're continually going against the word of God, you might not be His. There's too many people that are coming forward and they cry and they go out and they live the same. You got to be careful. But right here in verses 45 through 48, let's read it real quick. Luke chapter 12, verse 45 says, but if that servant says in his heart, my master is delaying his coming, and begins to beat the male and female servants and to eat and drink and be drunk, the master of that servant will come on a day when he is not looking for him, at an hour when he is not aware, and will cut him in two and appoint him his portion with the unbelievers, or the unfaithful is a better word. And the servant, that servant who knew his master's will and did not prepare himself or do according to his will shall be beaten with many stripes. And I truly believe that what that's saying is you are going to lose out on what God had intended for you. You're going to get beat up because of that. Listen, there's a couple things. One is that with this passage of scripture right here is that he's talking to somebody that might be playing church, right? It comes in, they hear all the words, they know the scriptures, but yet they go back out and live just as if there was no such thing as Jesus Christ in hell. The second is, he could be speaking to hirelings. It's not just you in the seats, it's the person that's giving the message also. Because there's many hirelings in the pulpit today that do it for a living. Because they get paid. If you took their money away, they probably wouldn't be doing it anymore. But they don't care about the sheep. Now you know, you have a shepherd that cares as the shepherd works with the sheep, talks with the sheep, prays with the sheep. He's concerned about people. And the last thing what I just shared a minute ago is it could be a false convert. Do you think there's false converts in the church today? Do you think that there's some people that come to church and they think they're saved? And they go like this, nah, just take this with a grain of salt, man. But how many people come to church, they say they're a Christian, they can quote John 3:16, but God is going like this, I never knew you. Why would God say that to us? It could be that. It could be false conversion. Or there's this side of it too. That there's people that are on one level of Christianity. Somebody's been walking and they've been growing. They know the scriptures. They've been serving the Lord. They're fired up. And then there's other people that are not that fired up. They're still saved. But they're just not that fired up. Either way, God is saying in this passage of scripture, you need to be careful, just like he started out. Be careful. Beware. Because this is what's happening. This is what's happening. You can get to heaven being a scoundrel. You can make it into heaven, right? It's not for me to say who's going to heaven and visit and praise God for that. Amen? Otherwise, God wouldn't make it. But you know what we do when we live that way? Listen. This is what we do. When we live as if there is no God. When we do our own thing, this is what we do. We rip ourselves off for eternal rewards. See, God has a plan for each and every one of us. He says, I know my thoughts towards you, thoughts of good, not evil, to give you a future and hope. He wants the best for you, he wants the best for me, that's me. So, but he wants the best in eternity. When this old body drops off, God's saying, I want you, when you enter into eternity, I want you to have the best eternity possible. I want you to have such a glorious eternity. How do I get that glorious eternity? By here. This is the testing ground. What am I doing here and now? Am I feeding people? Am I sharing the gospel? Am I studying the Word of God? Am I sitting at Jesus' feet and pouring my heart out to Him? Am I interceding for my family? Because right here and now, everything I do, whether it's prayer, evangelism, helping people, whatever I do in Jesus' name, guess what? He's rewarding me in heaven. He's putting it on my account. Some of us are going to go up there, we're going to get a glorious place, and some of us are going to get an outhouse. You're going to get there and go, that's it? He goes, that's all you sent up, son. What's it enough? I think an outhouse in heaven is better than burning like a sausage on Sunday morning, man. Either way is good. I mean, whether it's an outhouse or whether it's a mansion. But you know what? Jesus is pretty harsh with his language when he says cut in two. And what Jesus does is he's getting our attention. You guys, wake up. God is so concerned about your eternal rewards, about your eternal being. When Jesus says this, he's saying, I'm so concerned about you and what you're going to have in eternity. How many people got kids in this room? Man, you guys got a lot of kids in here, man. What do you want for your kids when they grow up? Do you want the best? Do you want the very best for your children? I work hard and I save money because I want to be leading my kids something. But when this old body drops off, you know, it's all done. I want to be able to leave my kids. That's God's heart towards us, you know that? Amen. He wants to give us a future. He wants to give us the best. But he says, in order to do that, you need to seek me. I'm the giver. I'm the one that's going to give. You know, when you start seeking God, it's not like it's a burden or anything like that. But there's coming a time when we're getting rewards. And that's what he's talking about on the other side. 2 Corinthians 5:10 says, for we must all stand before the judgment seat of Christ to receive our reward. I'm getting a reward someday from Jesus. I'm going to stand before him and see God say, this son over here, son, this is wood, hay, and stubble. You guys know what wood, hay, and stubble is? That's the stuff that I did outside of God. It's going to be burned up. The other side is going to be my rewards. The good thing is, I will never have to fear hell, neither will you if you're born again. You'll never have to fear hell. Because God, even though I might get all this stuff burned up, you go, God, you see, Mom, when I'm standing before God, you're going to probably get your marshmallows out. You know what I'm saying? There's going to be a big old bonfire going. That's cool. And as long as I made it, how about you? As long as I made it. So the thing is, be faithful. Be faithful to God. Be faithful with what God has given you. You know, Martin Luther, was out pulling weeds in his garden, the great Protestant reformer, the guy that came out of a Catholic church and started the Protestant movement, comes from protest. He protested against the Catholic Church and what they were doing. He was out weeding his garden one day. Some guy came in by and he said, if Christ came today, would you change what you're doing? He said, no. He was right where God wanted him. It's so important to know that you're right where God wants you. You don't have to be hanging out tracks and doing all this stuff. There's time when my garden needs to be weeded. And God will say, weed your garden. There's time when the lawn needs to be mowed. I'll have the ranch come over and mow it. God bless you guys. Let's pray. Father, we love you. Thank you for your word. And just pray for our time. Your word to sink into our heart. I just pray that we would go back over these scriptures and let them speak to our hearts. Let us go deep into our heart. Lord, you are talking to us when you tell us to beware, when you tell us to seek first the kingdom of God. You're telling us what is best for each and every one of us. Help us to take heed. Help us to listen to what you're telling us, God. With every head bowed, I just want to give anybody an opportunity to get right with the Lord this morning. If you're not walking with God, if you haven't read your Bible all week, pray it all week, then guess what? If you're not walking with God, or you might be saved, but you're not walking with God. The Bible says that God is a jealous God. He doesn't want you to put anything before Him. Not a husband, not a wife, not a family, not a job. He desires to be first in your life. If you need to get right with God, raise your hand up right now. Amen. Everybody else, amen. 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 All his hands go up everywhere. Amen. We're gonna play a song. And I'm gonna ask Pastor Zach to come up and Misty. I'm just gonna spend a little time in prayer with you guys. Just to help each other, to pray for each other, encourage each other right now. In Jesus' name, amen.